I wanted to give a little bit of history of why connectivity is important to us at this point and this time. And really, connectivity for the Great Northern LCC has been important from day one. At the very first steering committee in April of 2010 here in Bozeman, the steering committee, the first day, identified five priorities, one of which was connectivity. That carried forward into our strategic framework as both a goal and a conservation target. So it's a pretty important thing for us all over. And then it carried forward into our science plan, which just got approved last fall, both in looking at landscape integrity and, again, as a conservation target and, as one of our goals. So from day one, connectivity has been a high priority and a very big impetus for the Great Northern working together. And, you know, why? Obviously, fragmentation, land use, whether it's ex-urban development or energy development or conversion of ranch lands, we're losing about 6,000 acres a day of habitat, which is pretty significant. I don't have to tell this room that the bloody, I call this the bloody map. You know, I don't have to tell you this. But what did surprise me when I first saw this map, and I have to thank Gary Tabor for this and many of the other slides I have today. What did surprise me is, you know, certainly for the large-bodied carnivores, I understood the range contraction. But, you know, look at elk and look at pronghorn and some things that I really didn't expect, you know, just gut feeling had such a range contraction. But it has been pretty ubiquitous among wildlife species in the U.S. and, you know, in North America. And finally, climate change, has come on. It's been happening. We've recognized it, I think, more recently. This is just a study that, you know, the number one recommendation out of all of them is to increase connectivity. And then recently, more to the point, because I'm a Park Service employee, we have a new science mandate, if you will. We're working on changing it to policy now, and it's all about working with the changing climate and how does one manage land under volatile changes that we don't yet fully understand. And, you know, it says parks, and you could say forests, or you could say, you could say your state wildlife preserves, anything, any land that we manage, they're embedded in a larger regional and continental landscape. Connectivity is essential for system resilience over time. So in the face of climate change, connectivity becomes even more important. This is another slide Gary gave me we are growing as a nation, as a country. We are growing, and I'm going to point this out again and again. Some of the places are still. Let me see if I can do this right. You know, kind of around the outline here. This is the kind of the area we work in. So we in our area are still not necessarily growing as fast as some of the rest of the country. Since day one, the Great Northern has supported connectivity science, and I mean Washington Connected, and some of the work up in the Crown, some of the bear work that Chris and Michael have been doing, the state chats, as well as the WGA chat, it's been a high priority for us to support science, collaborative science. And that was, you know, we seemed like that was going pretty well until one day, in Leavenworth, Washington, we had a tectonic shift in the paradigm of thinking about collaborative science was good enough. And you know, Ian came in after 4 days of workshopping, two for science planning and two for our steering committee, and he said, look, we've got to move beyond collaborative science. We've got to get into shared action. And he found some like-minded members of the steering committee and the advisory team, and he decided to create this, you know, he sort of organically, I'd say, created this thinkers group that wanted to say, we're going to find some issues that we can work on shared action with. And connectivity came up as one of the highest issues. Aquatic invasive species is another, and there's another work group working on that. So I would say this was a tectonic shift in our thinking of moving from collaborative science to shared action. And so the outcome of the workshop is really the purpose is to identify actions to facilitate connectivity at the GNLCC level. This is all about shared actions at the GNLCC level. GNLCC is, if you're not too familiar with it, it's kind of big. 287 million acres, if you're thinking in acres like I do. Parts of five states and two provinces. It was quite surprising to our Canadian colleagues to find out we had drawn our boundaries up into their territory, but they were game, and they came around, and we very much appreciate that. So you know, I think we probably need to just start about, you know, kind of get on the same page of what we mean by connectivity, because you can look it up in many different ways, in many different formats, and you can find many different definitions of it. I really just took the definitions out of this primer that the Center for Large Landscape Conservation did, and they reviewed a lot of different connectivity literature. It's the degree of which the landscape facilitates or impedes a movement. And, you know, taken to the biggest extreme, you can talk about ecological connectivity, which supports the movement of both biotic processes and abiotic processes. We're going to mainly be talking about terrestrial habitats today, about corridors, a distinct component of the landscape that provides connectivity, and about wildlife corridors, specifically in terrestrial habitats. And this is really phase one of what we expect to be a much longer project, that we're really, you know, right now talking about terrestrial fauna and habitats. But we've already got a proposal into the Great Northern Story Committee to do a phase two where we'll add in some other things, aquatic fauna, avian fauna. And so, you know, we know that we're not going to get to where we want to at the end of the 2 days today or this week, but we have a longer term plan to continue this work. So as a collaborative, I'd say, you know, we've got a long way to go. We are here as a collaborative. Now, some of you individually or collectively in your things are here. You know, some of you are here. Some of you are here. Some of you are even here. I mean, there's many great examples of people who are doing great connectivity work in landscape. And we're going to hear from a lot of you, from the Washington Connected Cascadia folks. We're going to hear from the Grizzly Bear folks and some of the really fine work that they're doing. We're going to hear from the High Divide Collaborative. So we've got a lot of good examples of case studies that are farther on. But as a whole group, we've got a long way to go to have connectivity across a large landscape. You know, why? Well, it's interesting. There's a lot of science out there, and we all use different science, and some of it's kind of complex. Some of it's kind of difficult. A lot of it's modeled. Some of it's empirical. Some of it's, you know, modeled and empirical. And, you know, as a manager, it's kind of hard to find, it's sometimes hard to find the science, and it's sometimes difficult to use it. And so I think we will address that today. You know, this is the WGA Westwide chat versus some connectivity, aquatic connectivity work we're funding up in the Flathead. Scale. Scale is a huge issue. It's been identified by everybody that works on the ground. A lot of the science that we have provided has been very coarse-grained, large-scale stuff. How do you translate that down to action on the ground? I'll pick on my own agency, the National Park Service. Our director at a meeting I was at called us the best run ships and the worst run Navy. We're, you know, 400 independent units out there on the landscape, and I suspect that's not that unfamiliar to many of you. So, you know, your agency, your organization, or unit priorities versus working in a larger landscape matrix. And then finally, you know, complex ownership and jurisdiction. We are, when you talk about wildlife specifically, we all know that, you know, we're all work on that arena, and we all know how difficult and complex that is. So there's a lot of obstacles to success. What we hope to do today is to work on overcoming some of those obstacles. How? Well, I'm really excited about the Atlas, and I even spelled it correctly. And I think that brings a lot of the science that we know about into one place, into one format, and it helps you discover what's out there and use what's out there. So we're going to have Meredith and Dave Theobald talk about that a bit today. We're going to have a lot of work sessions and breakout groups, and we're going to talk about the diverse institutional landscape, existing partnerships, and hopefully begin to form new partnerships as well. Review a bunch of successful case studies. I've mentioned that already. And finally, generate recommendations to the steering committee about short-term priorities and long-term strategy, and to maintain and enhance connectivity throughout the GNLCC. And the steering committee is actually very excited about this project. I think Ian and maybe John presented it to them in Waterton a year ago, and they're jazzed about it. So the outcomes, I'm going to just hit on these really quickly because John is going to talk about them more in depth. You know, better integrating data mandates and partnerships, identifying information gaps and barriers, and then recommending near-term priorities, you know, to the GNLC steering committee, how, where, and what the data gaps are. And finally, you know, they recommend the next steps for creating a strategy for this entire landscape, this 287 million acres that we worked in. So, you know, I hope at the end of this phase one of the project, we've moved from down in the valley to up, you know, up somewhere in the mountainside. I don't want to underestimate the importance of the steering committee to the success of this project, because there's a lot of power. You know, if you just look at the organizations on the steering committee and you look at the people in the steering committee, there's a lot of power to make things happen. And this is a group that's really excited about what we're doing here, not only today and tomorrow, but this whole phase one and generating a strategy. So, you know, I don't want to underestimate the importance of having the steering committee there. Thank you to Dave Theobald for this slide, just saying that, you know, the time is now. If this is a proxy for land, human modification, because it's you know, night skies. And as you can see, the time is now, because Carl Schieler said yesterday, it's never going to be better than it is today. It's only going to erode from here. So we can, you know, preserve what we have and even maybe make it a little bit better in some areas. And I think the place is here. If you can see, this is an older connectivity map that Dave and his group published. You can see the GNLCC. Thanks, Meredith, for overlaying this. Where you can kind of see the GNLCC. We are in the midst of some north, south, and east, west, pretty strong connectivity corridors. So we are in a good place to be doing this kind of work, to be piloting this kind of work for the rest of the nation. So that's why we're here. I think we need to seize the moment, and I very much appreciate y'all being here to do that with us. So thank you.